So my presentation will be slightly more technical because it relates to science. And I will try to make it as simple as possible. And I hope you'll bear with me. As it was introduced about the mission which we have in the agriculture science and science in general, of course India is not a leading country in the science, but we are trying to catch up in different fields like
light dilane ke liye keh rahe hain,
light dilane and other things. We are quite ahead, but in agriculture also we have made our country self-reliant in the food production except for the oil seed and pulses. So there are many challenges. Agriculture is of course the very backbone of this country. It used to be more than 85% people were engaged in agriculture, which has come down to 60%. So still majority of the people are in agriculture. So here I will talk about one particular subject is called genome. How many of you have heard about genome? Few people must have heard about genome because it relates to biology. Genome is the complete set of genetic information present in a single cell of any organism. So all the living things on this planet, starting whether it's a bacteria or plant or fungi or animal or human being, they are made of cells. And within those cells, all life starts from a single cell, whether it's a multicellular or single cellular organism. So the complete genetic code is there, and that code decides what you will become. Whether you will become a human, or you will become an elephant, or you will become a tree, it depends on the genetic code, just like the computer program. So we have taken a mission to decode the different plant species which we grow as a crop. So that is the definition of this. Then why do we decode a genome? Because this is a quite expensive science. It requires expensive equipment and the chemicals and all those things, most of which has to be imported from abroad. So one thing you must appreciate that it was said that we are trying to make the country self-reliant. How does a country become self-reliant? Because if you are able to generate most of your need for your consumption yourself, there should not be a large gap between export and import of various kinds. So we generate our income, there are different sectors are there. One is called technology sector, then manufacturing sector, and the service sector. So at present, India is making most of its money from this service sector. We are very poor in manufacturing, and in the technology we are way far behind. So because of this age of IPR, intellectual property, the people who own the technology, you just look around you, most of the things which are using high technology, they are not made in India. And even if they are made in India, the royalty goes to people who own the technology. And who will develop the technology? Who are strong in the science. Like the European countries, America, and then Japan, and now China is coming up, Korea. These are the people who develop the technology because they have a strong R&D base. So they become self-reliant because they will be exporting to you and you will be paying. And how do we earn our money? Mainly through services. Services person gets the pay the least. So that's the objective, that we want to become as much reliant on this technology front. Don't move so fast. So once we understand the genome of any organism or many organisms, so that helps us in many ways. The first is that very basic curiosity of the human knowledge, that where we come from, how different species are related to each other. Then if you know the theory of evolution, which is the present world view of how the species have evolved, so we all have a common ancestor. All the species have evolved from a common ancestor, including the bacteria and human and plants. I will show you a slide of that. So once we know the complete genetic code, we can actually construct that tree of life, that how far back we had a common ancestor. And then this has got several applications, like characterization of our genetic resources. All the variability that we have, which is the basic building block of developing new varieties, and those building blocks can be identified so that people cannot steal our resources. Something is called the biopiracy. Like India is a poor in technology, but it's very rich in the biodiversity. It has got so many different kinds of plants and animals, variability which can be utilized for the gains, for the industrial gains. So we have a right on that. But how are you going to protect it unless you have a technology to identify that somebody has taken our material? Like you know the technique of DNA fingerprinting, which is now used very commonly in solving this paternity dispute and also criminal cases. One can tell from certainty that this particular sample of the hair or the blood belongs to a particular person, if we have the suspect. So this kind of technology can be also used in the plants. If somebody steals your material, and then you can challenge them. Then we go down and identify the genes. Genes are the one who do the job, whether the plant will be short or tall. It might depend on a single gene. And have you heard of Green Revolution? How many have heard of Green Revolution? I think many people have heard. It's a very common term called Harit Kranti. In the 1960s, India was having a begging power. It used to go to America and import the food. The wheat used to come on the PL480 program. And that's how we were feeding ourselves. But over the period, now India is one of the biggest exporter of rice. It also exports wheat and many other commodities because of the scientific breakthrough and effort from the different angles. Now I will just very briefly describe you that how as a nation we have participated, we have started our journey into decoding of the genomes for the crop plants. So the genome revolution actually began in 1990s. In the America with this new DNA sequencing technology platforms were created, and there was one project for the human genome and the other project was for a very small plant of the mustard family, a weedy plant, because the genome size was small. So that was a model plant species, and then human was the model animal species. Because once they found the way to decipher the genetic code, then they set up a very big program to decode the entire human genome, which is 3 billion base pair. Base pair is the letter, just like you have ka ka ga ga in Hindi and ABCD in English. So DNA has an alphabet of 4 letters, A, C, G, T. And then we have the technology to read it all. And the people set out to read this DNA code of the human so that that will help in the different kinds of diseases, genetic diseases, and the implications in the medical industry. That time India did not participate because when you are a laggard, when you are lagging behind, you have to learn from the people who are advanced, more advanced than you. But if you don't do it, then you will keep on going further and further behind. So unfortunately, we are not there, but in 2000, we joined this international program for decoding of rice genome. So this genome information we have used, and now more than 50 plant genomes are available. Many animal genomes are also available because from 2000 to now 2016, the varieties of the plants, the rice, of which we are growing, they are just selection from the wild. So when we select those material, we lose so many genes because out of thousands of lines, we pick up only one, which is for the cultivation. So the variability which is present there, which is the essence of survival, all these grass and animals and plants which are surviving out in the nature, they have genes for resistance because they don't go to the hospital for treatment. When you become sick, you will be going to the hospital. When your crop plants become sick, then you will be spraying some medicine, some treatment, some insecticide or fungicide. But those plants which are growing in the jungle, does anybody take care of them? They take care of themselves because they have the genes, they take care of themselves. So whenever we need some genes to do this job, we have to go back to the wild. So what if then that have collected thousands of different wild rice successions. So during domestication and breeding, we have left a lot of variability behind. Of course, now we are losing it at a very alarming rate because of the developmental pressure. Our population has grown 4 times more, and there are very few natural places are left. We have cut all the jungles. We have got all the grassland, we are making buildings. So very much material is left, but they are very rich source of the genes. So this we have done. So having this genome data, the complete what you can jal kundali of rice, or the complete blueprint of the rice, And there is a variation, different varieties have slightly small variations. We are able to, those are the ones which determine the traits, like one variety can have only 200 grains in the pancreas, other variety may have 400 grains in the pancreas. So this is the variety on the left side, which contributed to the green revolution. But in our material, we have variety which can have 400 grains in the pancreas. So they can, actually we can double the production, or we can increase the production in much faster rate, with keeping pace with the growing population. And then the rice which elongates, you eat the basmati rice which is very long in green, that is also governed by genes, variety which will be tolerant to different stresses. So we set out to identify these, and then we have identified the genes which are now being used in the breeding program. So that the new varieties which have been developed, they have got high quality, high yield, as well as tolerant to different stresses. And that is the reason why from a begging bowl to India has now become self-sufficient, not only self-sufficient, it is a biggest exporter of rice. So this is, you can see the how when we have this genome information. So rice is a leading crop where we have the variety and we have so many in the pipeline, so we can face any situation. In fact, we can produce more rice from less land now, that kind of situation is available with this kind of scientific breakthrough. The same is not true with any other. But there are some people from Australia and USA, they are also sequencing the mango genome. But our is much more ahead and much more complete. So this Amrapali variety, which is a hybrid, this is the first hybrid mango variety which was developed here in Pusa 40 years ago. Because this is once again, this is a dwarf kind. You can get fruit at very small stage, so it has got several advantages. It's a regular fear. Like, you may have seen the mango tree. It will fruit 1 year, but next year it will not fruit. It's called alternate bearing. And this kind of problem, mall permits, so there are many problems are there with the mango. So availability of the genome can solve those problems, and we can develop superior variety of mango. So that you can have mango throughout the year, not only in the season. Next. Mango is most closely related with, you can't read it, but with the citrus. You'll be surprised that among the available genomes, mango and citrus are the most closely related. So one is very sour, one is very sweet, so there's very few gene difference make it, you know, whether it's citrus or mango. So it all goes back to all the plants and animals that are closely related to each other. Next slide. I'm coming to an end now. We also called the international people at Pusa here 2 years back to develop the collaboration, because we know that the value of collaboration is that rather than doing everything yourself, if you can join hand, my previous presenter beautifully told us how people can, you know, work together for a common cause. So we had invited them on the principle of our ancient wisdom, Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahana Vanatu, Sa Viryam Karvahe, Tejasina Vadhita Mastu, Ma Vipsavahe. Om Sahana Vipsavahe. I will tell the meaning of this. Sahana Vavatu, maybe we are being protected together. Then we are nourished together, we work together with a great zeal and energy so that we can achieve a much, much higher goal. And while doing this, there should be no jealousy with each other. Like when we work together, we should not think that this person has gone ahead, I'm lagging behind, I did not get this person. Because we have to work with the common cause together. Because we are all interconnected. I showed you that we are not only we, even the plants and animals, they are all interconnected. We have a common origin, we are all interrelated, we are all interdependent, and so that if you have that feeling, we can work for a common cause. So with this, I would like to thank you very much.